In the next few minutes, I'll describe the status of the Extreme Life Infrastructure Facility, which we built in Bucharest, and the opportunities for research in the field of hyperfine interactions. So our mission is to do nuclear physics with high-intensity lasers and brilliant gamma beams. And we have two arms of 10 petawatts synchronizable lasers and a bright narrow bandwidth polarized gamma beam. ELI-NP was declared a landmark laboratory of S3 in 2017 together with FAIR and Spiral2. These are the three laboratories in Europe in nuclear physics. And in the NUPEC 2017 long-range plan, it was defined as major nuclear physics facility. So the laboratory building is fully operational. As you can see, it has 17,000 square meters. The red contour line here is an anti-vibration slab. So the standard which was set that the platform cannot vibrate with amplitude higher than 1 micron and frequency higher than 10 hertz. The building is fully thermalized with geothermal water. We use something like 6 megawatt of geothermal water. And of course, for the lasers, we have a clean room of high class. So the platform is put on anti-vibration mounts, and you can see in the basement there are about 1,000 springs and dampers. So you can look at this as 150,000 ton optical table. In this building we'll have the two lasers, the electron accelerator for production of the gamma beams, and of course experimental areas and laboratories and workshops. The 2018 Nobel Prize was given to, one half of it was given to Gerard Mourou and Donna Strickland, and it was awarded for their method of generating high intensity ultra short optical pulses. So on the scale of high power laser facilities, we're expected to operate somewhere here with 10 petawatt. This is what you can see nowadays in the laser room. The two arms are fully mounted. Here at the end, you can see the 10 petawatt compressors. So on the diagram, this is a 70 meters long laser. They have both of them common front end, and here these are the pumping lasers. We'll have two outputs of 100 terawatt each, which will operate at 10 hertz. Two outputs of 1 petawatt, which will operate at 1 hertz. And at the 10 petawatt, we expect to have 1 pulse per minute. So the key word here is contrast. We'll have pulses with 250 joules in 25 femtoseconds, and we expect to have 100 picoseconds before the pulse, a contrast of 10 to the minus 14. The 3 megawatt performance was confirmed in June last year. You can see here the pictures of the beam spot. And last week, we confirmed 10 petawatt, which means that the injected energy is already about 110 joule. So what you can do with this, you can accelerate particles, electrons or ions. And the laser intensity at this power is expected to be 10 to the 23 watts per square centimeters, which converted in light pressure is about 10 terabar. So with such a pulse, if you shoot on a nanometer foil, you'll blow up all the electrons and they'll create a huge electric field drawing up the ions behind them. So you get beams which scale with the Avogadro number. And with this we want to study neutron-rich nuclei. We want to have ultra-intense ion, gamma or neutron sources. And we want to study nuclear reactions in plasmas. So the timeline, we are much ahead. We expect to have 10 petawatt according to the plan in June, but we'll get it much earlier. We are building the transport system and we're building the commissioning experiments. So what we can do in plasmas, we can study processes. So reactions in stars happen in plasmas where you have the electrons, and you can study processes where you capture a photon which is emitted through an electron transition, and you can make nuclear excitations, or you can capture a photon from an electron coming from the continuum, and such a process which is called NEEC is never observed so far. So this can have complications on astrophysics processes because, for example, this isomer in 93 moly leaves 7 hours, but you can excite it and then you can excite this state and then bypass the isomeric decay, and this will have a huge influence on the reaction transition rates. Related to the P process in stars. The ultimate goal of this program is to populate neutron-rich nuclei, and this can be done by one can shoot on a composite target with a high-power laser, and here there is some thorium which will be accelerated. Some deuterium on a thorium backing, both of them will be accelerated, and then they hit a tick reaction, a tick target, and in this region there will be a huge density of fusion products, fission products, which then can fuse, and one can create exotic nuclei. So we have developed a program related to day one experiments, which was approved by the advisory committee. And for example, a key experiment will be to accelerate 200 MeV protons and to demonstrate, of course, the laser intensity which we achieve. So the gamma beam system will work on laser Compton backscattering of accelerated electron beam, so that the scattered photon is amplified with the square of the Lorentz factor, and in this way we'll get photons up to 20 MeV with a very narrow bandwidth. So how this compares to existing facilities? This is at the moment the pulse at New Subaru in Spring 8 in Japan. It has this long energy tail because laser is scattered from an electron beam which is stored in a storage ring, and you feel the low energy electrons also in the beam. We expect to have much narrow pulses, and this is due to the very well defined electron and laser pulse in the point of the interaction. So I'll not go in details. I should say that we'll have two interaction points for low energy gamma beams and high energy gamma beams, and the synchronization between the lasers and the electron beam should be better than half a picosecond. I have to be very honest that with the gamma beam system we have a huge delay in the performance. We have some disagreements with the providers, but meanwhile we are preparing for the commissioning experiments and we are building the experimental equipment, and we believe that this will be overcome. So first we have to do the beam diagnostics, and for this we have to monitor the spatial, temporal, spectral and power parameters of the beam, and we create a family of devices which will be available to the users according to their experiments, and they'll be able to integrate the system in their data acquisition systems. So what we can do with this, you have a very well defined probe, which is the photon. You can tune it to a certain level and study the decay of this level, which is called nuclear resonance fluorescence. Or you can shoot above the particle separation threshold and measure photonuclear disintegrations or giant and pygmy resonances, and also photofission. Of course, in a facility like this, we developed a big family of applications like material science with positron beams and different industrial and medical applications. So the implementation, we have two huge arrays of germanium and detectors and scintillators plus neutron detectors. We have contracted everything. We have the detectors, of course, and the implementation in the experimental halls will start in March this year. So the first array is of large volume clavar detectors of Tigris type. We are doing the detector tests, of course. With this we can do gamma-gamma coincidences, angular distributions, and polarization measurements. And we have defined a family of physics cases which focus on what we call the availability frontier, which means that with these pencil-sized beams which we have, we'll be able to address, to study samples with small quantities. At the moment in this type of experiments, you need grams in your sample, and we believe and we are sure that we'll approach the actinide region where we can have samples of as much as 100 milligrams. We can go to the sensitivity frontier, which means that we'll be able to measure very weak channels, and we can go to the precision frontier, where we can use the high intensity of the beam to improve the statistics of the experiments. So at day one, what we plan to do is to study thallium 180, and this is isotope which is found in nature only in isomeric state, which lives something like 10 to the 15th years, and it should decay with this M1 transition to the ground state, which lives 8 hours. There has been experiments with Bremsstrahlung, which studied the so-called doorway states, where you excite the isomer and the excitation bypasses the isomer. And there's list of levels which are suggested for such doorway states, and this we can measure with high precision already at the first days of the facility. We are building an array, a 4-pi array of large scintillators. What you can see here is the biggest collection of 3x3-inch scintillators, lanthanum bromide or cerium bromide. We have also lithium-6 glasses and a lot of liquid scintillator neutron detectors. With this, we want to study giant and pygmy resonance decays, and we'll combine the information with information from gamma N reactions. One of the case studies is to study nuclear polarizability, dipole polarizability, which depends only on the be one strength in nuclei, and through the neutron skin, this is related to the symmetry term of the nuclear equation of state. So a key problem here is low energy strength in the field of the pygmy resonance, and we'll be able to study very weak branches of the strength, which is not accessible by other means. So, say, an experiment which was done in Osaka in SCNP in 2008 late, took them about a month to do, and we believe that we can do the same measurement with within a generic week. So far, such studies are done, and we're in close collaboration with the group from Osaka, and they shoot on PP prime. They measure PP prime experiments, measuring the protons on forward angles. What I want to state is that their resolution at something like 5 MeV is about 30 kV, which is a fantastic achievement. Our gamma beam resolution is expected to be of the same order in this, so we can compare information between experiments with virtual photons and gamma beam experiments. In addition, it will be possible to distinguish between E1 and M1 transitions in these measurements and combine the information with the gamma N channel. For neutron cross sections, we are building an array of helium-3 detectors, and this is actually ready. It's a flat array over the meaningful range of neutron energies, with something like 40% emission. We have done the tests, and this is a reaction, PN reaction on natural aluminum, which is a test case recommended by the energy agency in Vienna, and you can see our experimental points are black. They agree with what is expected. A test case will be to study these resonance states in beryllium-8, and you can see the data from the two existing facilities. The crosses come from Duke University, and the green data come, and the black squares come from New Subaru. They differ drastically with each other. We have idea why this is so, and we believe that we can resolve the puzzle. On charged particle detection, we are building a time projection chamber with electronic readout. We have a prototype ready, which was tested in beam. And with this, we want to study the oxygen 16 gamma alpha reaction, which is the inverse of the alpha burning on carbon 12. And this we want to push towards the gamma window. So what we have done, this is a picture of such event in an optical TPC. You have one alpha particle coming here and two alpha particles going in diverge after decaying of beryllium-8. This is an event reconstructed with alpha particle in the TPC, and this is the in-beam test, so the readout is in the nomenclature of CERN, U, V, and W segments of the readout, and with this you can reconstruct NP event. We're also building a 4-pi spectrometer of silicon detectors, and for this we'll measure first BBN reaction of silicium-9. We did this, we started doing this at Duke, and we distinguished very well between the tritons and the alphas. And these are preliminary results of the cross section. We'll continue this measurement, and we'll do it, of course, with much higher precision when we're operational. We also develop instruments for photo fission, which are double-sided brachionization chambers. They are tested, they work according to the expectations, and these are the type of arrays which are in production. With this, we want to study transmission resonances, and here you tune the beam on a level in the first minimum, which couples itself to levels in the second or in the third minimum, and this is demonstrated as resonance structure in the fission cross section, which means that nuclear structure correlations would influence the fission probability. And this is a key experiment which we want to do in the first days of the facility. Of course, for photo fission, we develop also detectors based on the modern technologies in CERN. And we'll have four pi arrays of such a type of this TIG gem detectors, and they were tested, and we achieved very good spatial resolution. We'll also develop a facility for production of exotic nuclei, and here I come to possibilities for studies of hyperfine interactions. So, other than what is done at Aalto and Ariel, where they shoot with electron beam on a converter and then on a TIG target, we have the ready gamma beam, which can cover the width of the giant dipole resonance in uranium, and we can produce fission fragments in a gas cell. So we want to build a IGZOL facility, and actually this is our laboratory now, our ELI-NP laboratory, and this is an old research reactor which was decommissioned this year, last year, and we are building a new experimental hose towards the reactor. So the gamma beam is on the axis of the reactor hall, and we'll have also these laboratories, and here we'll develop our IGZOL facility. So the core of this is a cryogenic stopping cell, which we produce or we develop together with GSI Darmstadt and the University of Gießen. And in this cell, we'll have a number of thin uranium foils. Actually, we got the first foils from GSI to test them, I think, these days, or they are on their way. Actually, I was signing the paperwork to get them in the laboratory. And then the gamma beam will shoot on these foils, will produce fission fragments, and with different electric and magnetic fields, we'll drag them towards these Laval nozzles here. And in this second chamber, we'll have gas jets, which will drag the ions with them and will form the beam at this exit going to RFQ. So in reality, this is a huge device, which will be long as 4 meters, kept on cryogenic temperatures. This is the gamma beam, this is the first chamber, this is the second chamber. And as I said, we are doing a lot of R&D work to build this double chamber cryogenic stopping cell. So compared to existing stopping cell, this will have advantage because we extract the ions orthogonal to the beam. So this distance here is something 20-25 centimeters. Compared to the existing cryogenic stopping cell in GSI, which is 1 meter long, the beam is stopped in the volume of the cell, and the extraction goes along the axis of the cell. So the extraction distance is much higher, which increases the extraction time. So with this cell, we aim to have extraction of about 20 milliseconds, which gives us opportunity to study shorter-lived isotopes. So we have what we'll have is the gamma beam, which goes through a collimator, shoots in the stopping cell. We form the beam with RFQ, we analyze it or pre-analyze it, and we send it to Emertov for separation of the isotopes of interest, and then we go to a detector station. look. This is the layout of what we expect to build. Of course, the first thing was to simulate the fragment distribution, and this we have done at different gas densities and using different models for stopping. Then we have studied the space charge which can be generated in the gas cell, and of course the most of the generation is around the target system. I should say that with the beams which we expect to have, we look at something like 10 to the 7 to 10 to the 8 ions in the volume of the cell. So I was told that I can use some time from the next talk.
No?
Yeah,
you should summarize now.
Okay, I'm going to the summary. So we understood what is the space charge which we have. We have studied the different regimes, and we expect compared to facilities which work like EGISOL 4 or Caribou, our curves expect to be these for the heavy and for the light fragments. And of course now we study the jets in the second cell, and we are building a prototype to visualize the jet and to understand them. And this I'll skip because this was the next talk. So my conclusion is the instrumentation for the ELI-NP experimental program is implemented according to the project time schedule. The physics cases which will be addressed have been prepared within a broad scientific community. Commissioning and then day one experiments are currently under discussion. We'll have a user workshop in the fall of the year, and we'll provide beams for users in early 2021. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So.